Okay, thank you all for coming to our Monday afternoon seminar. Our speaker today is Ángeles Molina, who will tell us about dark matter halo. So, Ángeles, please, you have the floor.
Okay, but if I put continue, I have to change, sorry. Again. Okay, perfect. Thanks for the presentation. Can you see my screen now?
Yes.
Perfect. So, well, yes, the idea, thanks to give me now the space to present this seminar. The idea is to explain the main halo and subhalo properties that are fundamental to estimate the signal for dark matter, the signal in particular, as we'll see. So let me start with a few briefly introduction. The problem with, sorry, just one thing. The problem with this, my God. The problem with pages or keynote, sorry, it's not possible now change the screen. I don't know what is happening. So maybe I can
hit it with the mouse.
Okay. Behind mouse.
Or maybe don't use full screen, no? We could see before.
Yeah, but now I am in full screen, but it's not possible to change the slide. I don't know why, what is happening now today. Well, maybe it's not the Vedotion, but I come again with maybe Adobe.
Yeah, and we. Yeah, perhaps we can continue like this, yes.
Yeah, maybe we please. See, no? In this way, sorry, but maybe it's the quick way to solve the situation, right? Okay.
I think the one that worked for Guillermo was preview, if I remember correctly. But I'm not 100% sure.
Well, okay. Well, maybe we can start.
This works. This works.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, maybe the best option. So, well, I start with a brief introduction about the astrophysical and cosmological evidence. As we know, rotation curve of galaxies, observation of the CMB, gravitational lensing, observation of large-scale structure, and also BBN, tell us that we need some matter in our universe. And just to understand such observations, the different candidates for that, we can found in particle physics, but also is now, well, it's possible to think about primordial black holes as a part of this matter. And so, we have different masses for the different candidates and also different properties of the candidates. But the idea is that the candidate have to be some general requirements for theoretical models. For example, the non-baryonic, neutral, stable on cosmological scales. We still don't know if it's interact any other way than through gravity. And of course, massive, because we know or we expect that the matter cover the 27% of the universe, of the mass of our universe, of the mass in terms of energy and the mass of our universe, about 85%. So in this way, have to be cold or warm. So the different the requirement is also is more important about the particle physics candidate. And in this talk, my idea is also to present how we can to or intend to detect the dark matter with different methods. The more usual methods are here, direct detection, indirect detection, and collider experiments. About direct detection, we expect the looks for the elastic scattering of dark matter with nuclei in highly sensitive underground experiment. We had recently a very nice talk about presented by David Cerdeño. Also about indirect detection, we had also different talks, for example, from presented by Viviana. The idea of indirect detection is that the different experiment on Earth or in space look for cosmic rays. We are seeing gamma rays, neutrinos, and antiparticles. Because there are, we expect that there are products of annihilation or decay of dark matter particles. Also, recently, a lot of work intend to understand how also use the oscillation, and see if dark matter oscillate into visible particles and vice versa. And also, in the case of Collider experiment, we have the idea is they can to produce dark matter particles from the collision of standard model particles. So in the case of Collider experiment, we have the inverse direction, no, respect to indirect detection, because in indirect detection, as I said, we expect to produce or to detect standard model particles as a product of dark matter, no, dark matter particles. In this talk, my idea is just to focus in indirect detection. One will see that I focus in some specific signal, but because it's more rich about the properties for halos and subhalos that we need just to understand. But the idea is that we have different ways to look for this kind of method and found the dark matter. In the case of this kind of method, we have different telescopes like Fermi for gamma rays, Veritas, CTA also, for neutrinos in the sea, Antares and IceCube, and Kamiokande in the mountain. No? For antimatter, we have PAMELA and AMS as a more popular, you know, way to look for the signal. My idea in this talk is not to present the different observations the different constraints that they found, the observation compared with theoretical things, but because we have a lot of some works or some talks recently about it. My idea is just to understand how to phenomenological or theoretical way to understand how to estimate the signal. The idea is for such signal, we expect from the center of our galaxy, the wall halo, dwarf galaxies and other astrophysical objects as the sun. This is a typical way to look for dark matter. And also the extragalactic signal. So how to see or how to expect the product of dark matter annihilation or decays from all the halos in the universe at all redshifts. I will focus in this kind of detection, again, because we can to understand why the halos and subhalos or the different structure are important in some kind of searches. I based on different works, so I start just to see or just to present the different ways of formula that we use. For example, for gamma rays and neutrinos in particular, as we see some mathematical quantities repeat in each and another one. So if we focus, for example, just an example, the neutrino flux, we see the same happen for gammas. We have that we can to understand and to explain, identify the particle physics part and also another astrophysical part. About the particle physics, we need the annihilation cross-section multiplied by velocity. And this is very important quantity. Just to is the way to understand that matter via constraints to putting constraints on this quantity. Also, in the case of neutrino, the different energy spectrum for number of neutrinos of a given flavor at emission. Also, the oscillation of neutrinos at, is the different leptonic mixing matrix in this U. The branching ratio for a given channel, the dark matter background density is just part of the astrophysical contribution for the signal of neutrinos, extragalactic signal. And also, the central or the more important for our talk, for the talk that I'm presenting now, is the so-called the enhancement of the annihilation signal arising due to clustering of dark matter into halos and subhalos. Why I see that is the more important? Well, because the way that this quantity is defining, we need to know the number of halos at a given mass, so the so-called halo mass function, and also the concentration parameter. The both quantities are of course astrophysics. I mean, the different we can to define these properties with different ways, but the more important or the more useful tool, because it's a strong help for us, are the simulation. For example, I show here the images for a given simulation that see for the high redshift the how the different structures, I mean, this extragalactic structure, we can to understand or we can to found or identify different halos here in this image, the different colors, the yellow circles, told us about the halos that we identify each simulation. No? So with this kind of way, no, just using simulation and also identifying the different structure, we can to find, for example, the number of halos that we have in the universe and estimate, and also using some theories in the past, and the concentration parameter that is no more than how dense are the different structures in that we are want to study. So for now, we will see, or we want to, I want that you remember both quantities, halo mass function and concentration parameter. I choose to do some exercise for this talk. Is what happens if we calculate this enhancement factor, which is due for structures in our universe, as I said, how we calculate or see the uncertainties when we change the way that we define the both properties of halos. For the moment, I'm talking about halos, okay? So what happened if I have, for example, some simulation that told me that the number of halos at a given mass have some particular shape? For example, when I move with mass, what happened if I have other simulation that maybe is not in good agreement with that? And okay, if this is happening, that is happening historically, happened a lot. What is happened with the enhancement factor and then the signal that I can to expect from the material annihilation. This is the main idea of this talk. So we play the game just to calculate in this quantity for different concentrations. But also we know that we have to define what is the cosmological model for the structure that we see in our universe. It's not the same if I am assuming the one model or another. As we say, the more receptive and more using the more receptive for the community cosmological model is the Lambda CDM, where the standard theoretical framework for structure formation, the universe is dominated by cosmological constant and collisional dark matter, the small density perturbation, gravitational instability, and form the bound structure that we say or we call dark matter halos. Inside the matter halos, we have substructures, sub-halos, and inside both structure, we expect, we found in more of the cases, a galaxies. No, this is the normal way, the more you see a way to define the structures of the universe. But of course, there are another ones, for example, warm dark matter and interacting dark matter models, and all of other possibilities just are including in the analysis for different reasons. Some of the reasons just have a solution. For example, we expect that we are very close to the solution, for example, for Milky Way settlement problem, but also the discussion is open for some works and so on. Also, but for the moment, there are other problems is continue with some open uses, for example, 2-big 2-fold problem, or the profile of galaxy halos. In the case of a 2-big 2-fold problem is Lambda CDM cosmology. The dwarf galaxies are expected to be hosted by halos that are significantly more massive than indicated by the measured galactic velocity. Another that is very related with that is the profile of galaxy halos that predicts, in the case of the standard model, predicts profiles with caspi cores and low outer density while densing. And dynamical observation indicate a central core of constant density and a flattening higher mass density of the profile, though this is still under. So this is why I presented here different cosmological model, because of course, as we are seeing here, the power spectrum, the linear power spectrum for different models, just for a standard one, cold dark matter, and interacting and warm dark matter, we see a suppression of the power spectrum at small scales. And this is impact directly with the properties of halos and subhalos. So if I want to estimate a signal, and such estimation is a function because I'm presenting the so-called halo model, it's necessary to understand the structure in the universe. Depending the model that I am assuming, I will have, of course, different results. In this talk, I will present some work that we would call elaboration about the difference between some both the different ways to for both properties. So the idea here when we define the enhancement factor is just to understand is all the different possibilities that we have. So again, if we do the exercise I said before, just to the idea is just to calculate this quantity, assuming different theories in the literature inside the cosmological model, the standard cosmological model, which is the lambda CDM, and also see briefly what happened when we change the model. So as I said before, the more important tool for a lot of years was the R, and actually also the simulation, no? And so we know that it's possible to imagine different methods from machine learning and so on. But in this talk, I will present some results for cosmological simulation. But we have different simulations depending on the scale that we want to study. See, if we want to study galactic scale, we have simulation that have a lot of resolution, a lot of particles to define a given halo. But if I want to describe the extra galactic signal, for example, what is my case today, I have to use a different simulation that have higher volumes. And also probably is the normal thing that we reduce the resolution of the simulation, the number of particles, and so on. So, but the idea is we have in the possibility to use different simulation depending the problem that we want to solve. In our case, for example, as I say, when we are thinking about to calculate the signal for all halos in our universe and different mass. So to calculate the enhancement factor, we have two integrals for the mass, for the halo mass, and also for the concentration, which are our main properties to define or to estimate phenomenological way, enhancement factor here. No? But also we have an enhancement for a given halo, because if I want to integrate all halos in the universe, I have to describe one in particular and each one, no? Each one is a function of the density profile, the so-called density profile, which is the number of particles, the distribution of the particles inside the halo. And we have different definitions for that. Here I show you, for example, more. Navarro, Frank and White, Iñasto, different kinds of Iñasto presentation, isothermal and Barker. So again, for the people that is not more, I think that all of us understand the idea, but for example, here we can see, for example, that the dark matter halo is the blue, like a spherical structure, and then we have the galaxy inside, and so we are talking about the distribution of the dark matter particles inside the blue, so the halo, no? Inside the halo only for the moment. And also we have other definition for these density profiles that, if you remember recently, Carlos Argüelles presented the way to define the dark matter density profile in just from the theoretical point of view. And it's another way to understand what happened with the distribution of particles, depending also of different cases and also different models and so on. But currently we have two ways to define this quantity, and the normal weight is from simulations that we have all these cases, and also a theoretical estimation, which is it's another one from our wishes. Of course, depending the profile that we are using, we have different concentration, because as we see, as I show you here, the density profiles are a function of the concentration. No? If we, for example, assume the NFW, the Navarone, Frank, and White profile, we have the very used definition for concentrations in this kind of works about the stratum formation and also for different topics, but especially for the thing that I'm talking today, which is the estimation of the signal for dark matter, and it's very, very used in very, very in different topics. And this concentration, assuming the NFW profile, is defining that like the radius between the virial radius, which is the radius of the halo, and some other very technical and quantity that depend of the profile, which the so-called scale radius, but it's not interesting maybe to understand right now what this is. But the idea is just to see how concentrating is the structure seen through the radius between both specific radius of the structure. And also to define the enhancement of the viewing halo, we need define the mass of the halo and also the overdensity with respect to the mean density of the universe, or sometimes the mean density respect to the critical density of the universe. But the idea is just to calculate the mass, which is correlated to the radio that we are seeing, and also the density profiles and so on. But what happened? This is here, for example, I show you different cases for the concentration parameter, assuming different models. All the models, except to P12, 2012, obtained the concentrations using simulations. So we have here that the simulation typically cover 10 to the 10 to the 15 or less, but is historically the normal range that the simulations cover. And then the way, because we suppose that in our universe, we have very, very small halos, very, very massive halos, still 10 to the minus 5, or still some people or some works see that it's possible to have 10 to the 11, minus 11 solar masses. So how I can to define something if I only, if we expect to know the different parametrization, I mean the different definition for our concentration in from simulation, and then can to cover only such small range, of course, that people in the community, the way to solve the situation is just to extrapolate the results, no? So here we have, for example, the difference between DM 14, no, the dashed line, dashed point line, respect to the P12, for example, which is the solid line. And for small masses, we have here very, very different values. And this impact of force in our enhancement factor, which is the exercise that we want to do if we calculate the thing with each parameterization, no? So we see here the difference. So is we see just to better the logically way to see that we need really we need to understand how the properties of halos are working in our universe in order to then to estimate the signal, no? The stragalactic signal. Also, is this maybe this definition tell us that this is very the important that have the concentration, because this is the way, no? We have that is fundamental how we define the concentration, because works in this way. This is the state of the art about this quantity, which is a work from Sanchez Miguel. Now we know, Miguel. And also, well, the idea, the work was just to compare the P12 that I presented before with all the simulation that they have in 2015. And just we see that this is working very well and is the more you see concentration parameter currently in different works. Well, the other important ingredient is the Heloma function, no? As I say. So again, we are here for simulation, and then we want to understand what happened for small halos and extrapolation again, no? So as we see, that is not the fundamental, the uncertainty that we had from the Heloma function is not strong respect to the concentration, but it's also important to see how the people, or how the different parameterization that we have in the literature. The names are the more popular Watson, Set and Dorman, and Tinker. This is more the more famous Heloma function in different words. And well, this is and then the possibility that we have. For example, we choose some definitions, no, that I presented before, and here we have the results for the enhancement factor. More than one order of magnitude if you use DM, so this one, the particular concentration parameter parameterization that extrapolate like a power law, as I saw before, for the concentration, respect, for example, the Prada or the Sánchez-Conde parameterization here, no? More than one order of magnitude to redshift zero. That is the more important contribution for the extragalactic signal that we have. So, but this is just to comparing for halos, forgetting that we have also two halos, forgetting the cosmological model. Because all of that is assuming the standard one, no? The standard cosmological model. So another way, because the concentration and the Heloma function is just the way to estimate the enhancement factor using the so-called Helo model, no? But it's also possible to define this quantity with the nonlinear power spectrum. And here I show you a work with Sefusati that compare what happened if we use the Helo model to define the enhancement factor or the power spectrum here, no? And this is other work by the Fermi collaboration that they compare the Helo function, the Helo model with the with a power spectrum approximation and in very good agreement. Because again, for this kind of, you know, theoretical way to define the enhancement factor, we had other uncertainty. For example, what is the minimal mass that we assume, this is for a Helo model, no? The minimal mass that we had is one of the different parameters that we have to choose to see the different option, no? Also here, this parameter told us about the slope of the Heloma function, but similar things happen with the power spectrum, and we have this our uncertainties. But the important thing is both ways are in good agreement in some particular assumption, and this is we see that it's no problem about the way that we can to define one or other. And depending, of course, where we're using for one another. Just to know that it's not the only way to define the enhancement factor, it's not only the Helo model, or other possibilities just to define. So if we stop with the cosmological model, the lambda CEM, and we move to other cosmological model, what is happened? What happened with the concentration? What happened with the Heloma function? Here, for example, we have an image that show that we have a very important suppression of the number of offset of the left image respect to the right one, the right panel here, forward dark matter respect to cold dark matter. And the same happened with the interacting dark matter model that assume or relax the condition that cold dark matter can to interact with, for example, photon in the early universe. Or also it's possible to relax the condition and assume that cold dark matter interacts with neutrinos. and the impact is similar for warm matter, we have different results. Again, because we have a suppression of the power spectrum for the Coulombic effects and different reasons. So what happened for example, assume the one interacting dark matter model, and this is what happened. The dashed line is accounting for cold dark matter, and the solid line for IDM, so the interacting dark matter model. And a very different, this is the Hellman function, and we have different results at slower masses. The same happened with the concentration parameter. As we see, it's not a good agreement between the model. For example, here, if we see the black dots that correspond to redshift zero, it's a good that both cosmological models are in good agreement, but for small masses, no. And we found a suppression of the concentration at a small scale, of course, related to the power spectrum and the way that the structure of the universe changed when we assume that cold dark matter interacts or not with other particles, the standard model particles. So, of course, this put a very some difference in the way that we come to define, again, our enhancement factor, which is our exercise today, to calculate in different contexts. For example, here we have to compare the dashing line, which is the cold dark matter, and the solid line, which is the idea, more than one order of magnitude, and this is we expect, no, because we see something like that for the concentration. So the same for the flux. For example, here I show you the gamma ray flux. Again, solid line IDM, dashed line cold dark matter, and one order of magnitude in the estimation of the signal, no, for gamma rays. Similar thing happened with neutrinos. Here I show you the specific channels that is not important for our talk because we are focused in to understand the properties of halos and subhalos, but just to say that these results are assuming dark matter mass, a particle dark matter mass of 10 GeV. But other results we have if we change the mass of our candidate, but in all the cases, because I did the exercise, in all the cases, we found an order about one order of magnitude in the difference between depending the model that we choose. Well, now for the moment we understand what happened with halos, but what happened with substructure is important, it's not important, have some imprint in our signal or not. Just to understand, we have the halo gain and small structure inside, which is a so-called subhalos, okay? And this is, for example, if we see for Via Láctea, no? Here, for some of the names, because I very well understand, I very well studied some different satellites, Draco, and different satellites that we can to use just to, for example, to compare our estimation with observations of the galaxies that some of them have. Another, we have dwarf galaxies, a very dark object that is more difficult to analyze, as we'll see, but this is the idea. What happens if I include the satellite that we have, for example, for a given halo, and if we want to continue with our estimation for the trigalactic signal, what happens if I assume the substructure of each halo of the universe at all of masses and all of redshift? Well, the thing is, the results are the high dark matter dominated systems are the different satellites that are very important. Both dwarf and dark satellite are good target. For example, gamma rays or neutrino dark matter searches. The evolution of the subhalo properties can be studied in detail using high resolution cosmological simulation in the same way that we did for halos. And now we have different simulations that give us an excellent statistic. In the past was not possible, but now we have an important improvement about the statistics that we can include in our expectations and analysis. And the complete distribution of subhalos inside large halos may boost the annihilation signal importantly. What we say that boosts the enhancement factor in particular, no? Because if I have a structure that are very concentrated, or maybe that have high densities, I have to include in my exercise, in this quantity enhancement factor, the in some way I have to specify what is the contribution of substructure. And this is here, no? The Wolf factor, the so-called Wolf factor, is similar, or is when again we need the here the number in this case of subhalos at a given mass. In this case, it's very similar, and also I need again the concentration. So, very similar analysis that we have for halos is possible to do with subhalos, but we'll see that is not easy. For different reasons, in the case of in the theoretical point of view, yes, but in the fact that the subhalo have more some problems just to define. So here we have to define the Wood factor, the hot halo luminosity, the subhalo mass function, and the subhalo luminosity. No, and what happened with the for example subhalo luminosity? How is how we can do? Well, definition is just the integral of the dark matter density profile of subhalos square, because we are thinking about annihilation, for this reason is square. And in the final, doing the different calculation, we see that it's proportional to the concentration in similar way, but in other case, the power of three. And so it's again very sensitive in this case for the subhalo concentration. As I said before, it's not easy or no, it's not, I mean, it's. Is we have to do some different estimation for subhalos in the way to understand the concentration, because the subhalos suffer tidal forces inside the halo, for example. So the outer part of the structure we lose is not that perfect or so easy to model the structure with an sphere or something like that, like what happened with halos. So it's not easy to define the radius of the subhalo. For example, here for NF value, I mentioned it before, this is the definition, no? And now I can to, it's not a good idea to define the concentration in this way because we have the tidal forces. So another good idea is to use this definition, which is the radius between the mean density of the subhalo respect to the and the density, the critical density of the universe. And finally, it's possible to write the concentration as a function of the maximal circular velocity of the subhalo, which is as the maximal velocity that have the particles inside the subhalos, and R max, which is the radius that with this maximal circular velocity is attained. So here we lose the problem to have the density profile, to know the density profile of subhalo, because it's difficult, because the profile has some cuts in the outer parts and different things that is. If we use the definition, we don't need to have a density profile for subhalos. But of course, in the literature, the people use the NFW concentration. So here I show you both cases, the NFW concentration and also the concentration in this different definition as a function of Bmax. And the thing, one of the question is if the concentration of halos are the same of subhalos. This was a thing that was very important in this field, no, in this area of in this kind of searches or kind of investigation that the people assume or just use it that the concentration of halos are the same of subhalos. So our work with collaboration and Miguel and Sergio Palomares Ruiz and other people, we investigate using simulations what happened about the concentration if we really try to understand the subhalos. For example, dividing the halo in different areas, what happened in the more internal part here, what happened in the intermediate ring here on the outer part, the other part, and also a calibration bin that include the halos, no? The different halos, just to compare the concentration for one and another one. All the analysis we did with the simulations that are Milky Way side halos. So for the moment, we only are analyzing the substructure inside Milky Way halos, not other small or high, just Milky Way halos. And we see that is the median subhalo concentration increased toward the halo center for subhalos of the same mass. Because here, in this plot, the black line accounts for halos. The colored lines and symbols account for substructure. And as this, as we see here, no, the internal part is the red, accounting for the red dots and red line. Intermediate, this magenta color and violet color, no? As we see that when we go inside the halo, the concentration increase. So this is the mean result. So the people that want to estimate the signal of thermal annihilation can to include this different, the dependency with the position of the subhalo inside the halo. And also the result is that we have different values for one another one. We use a lot of simulations and this simulation that we use are very good resolutions. But for the moment, we have here the analysis just for subhalos inside the Milky Way halo. As we'll see, this is important just to study another kind of halos. And it's another kind of uncertainty that we have to include, or we have to consider. So what happened when the people use it, that halos and subhalos are the same, and also the problem that we had for halos, no, that I said before, that extrapolation, like a power law, or use it, this happened. For example, Gao 2012 used the extrapolation like a power law and have, of course, a boost factor higher for the massive one and also for the lower massive. And here, the black curve in the people use in this work of Miguel also, they use the P12 parametrization that we see that is in perfect agreement with the simulations and is the more accepted today. But just is to see the difference that we found. But what happened if we also include our analysis that subhalos are different of halos here, the right panel, where the solid lines account for our results using subhalos, the value that we found for the concentration of subhalos, but with different slope again for the subhalo mass function here. In the same way that we can to study a halo mass function, we can to study the subhalo mass function and very similar results obtained. But it's some uncertainty. We have, for example, here equal different slopes, and different slope here show the colors. When the slope is lower, we have the red lines, and the black one is assuming the other estimation for the subhalo mass function. Also, what happened if we see, for example, the boost factor when we calculate it with using NFW profile, so the concentration that here we so called it C200, and also what happened if we use another one which is independent of the given density profiles, well, here are the different. So the idea is just to show as an example, but it's very used in the literature again. How the different definitions and specific proper studies of the properties in detail change the boost factor or change the enhancement factor, and then in the final change the signal, will change the estimation of the signal. Again, if we can to see the uncertainties with the cosmological, the standard cosmological model, what happened when we include, for example, the direct indirect model for substructure. Just to resume, a difference again appear. in the case of concentrations, that is independent of the given density profile, we have difference here. In this one, we did the analysis for different boxes of the simulation. I don't want to worry about this, but it's just to understand that it's not the same to study the substructure inside Milky Way halos, as I said before, or for halos that are more massive. No, in this case, the more massive halos are the blue dots, the blue symbols, and the Milky Way halos are the red one. Respect to the cosmological model, the IDM is are the dots in all the cases, and the cold dark matter standard model are the triangles. And we see that the difference start to appear for lower Vmax, which is the same for lower masses. What happened with our exercise? We also see the subhalomatic function. Well, for the Milky Way halos, it's very important. We have here the difference, but when we go to substructure inside larger halos, more massive halos, we see that the difference are not very important, as we expect for the way that the power spectrum for this model works, no? So it's also important, and this is give me the opportunity just to remark that it's important when we study small scales and substructure, what kind of halo, what kind of host halo we are studying. For this reason, the idea is to improve the analysis of all of that things using simulation that are able to describe bigger volumes. So here, for example, I show you a simulation, recently simulation, which is the Uchu collaboration, the people that performing this. They have here an halos and subhalos in volume that is 2 gigaparsec and it's a very high volume with a very good resolution. And so if we use, for example, this kind of simulation, we can to extend our analysis. Well, this is the thing that we are doing with Miguel and also Alejandra. Alejandra and other people. So we are just finishing our analysis about it. And the idea was just to see, just to include in the game the more massive halos. And what happened is the same, it's not the same. Well, here, for example, we have the dashing lines in this plot, in the left plot, in the upper left plot. The dashing lines account for our fit when we only consider subhalos inside Milky Way halos. And the solid lines account for the parametrization that we obtain when you include all the halos in the Uchu simulation. So for the moment in this plot, I don't see if I have, and I put all the substructure inside just to see what happened. But it's also possible to, and here, well, the different symbols account, for example, for other simulation that cover small halos respect to Uchu. Inside the Uchu collaboration, we have Shinushu, is another one, but it's part of all of this is part of the same collaboration. And well, for this reason, we have different symbols in the dot, but the important things is when we put all together, we try to do the effort to analyze the substructure for different halos and different, very, very different masses, we found a good agreement respect to the analysis if we only see subhalos inside Milky Way halos, but for higher masses, the difference starts to be important. This is putting, as I said, everything inside. What happened if I, for example, analyze the different mass halos? This is the objective, no? To extend the analysis. So here, for example, we have 10^7, 10^9, like dwarf structures, 10^9, 10^12, 12 or 11. Here in the green color account for Milky Way halos. So 10^11, 10^12. And so on, no? The more massive cluster and also the bigger one. And we see that Yes, we have difference in the concentration depending on what is the halo that we are studying. And this is for the first time that we know, or I mean, we believe that it's the first time that some analysis is doing and then obtaining, as we see here, that the, for example, the green symbols here, lower masses or lower Vmax account for subhalos inside Milky Way halos, no? And the other ones are less massive, no? The violet and also the red. And the concentration increase when we have more massive halos. And the same happen when we use it is another simulation, which is a particular case for U2, which is U2. Again, the blue symbol here account for halos that are more massive respect to the green and violet ones. I mean, the shape, I mean, the behavior is very clear about this. So halos inside more massive halos are more concentrated than the one for less massive halos. And also it's possible to see more dependencies, and very, very interesting for structure formation, because depending of one of these results, we want to, for example, to test the sun assumption inside the cosmological model. But the idea is also possible to do for the subhalo mass function, of course. And with this simulation, we can, for example, to see what happened with the subhalo mass function in 1, 2, 7 order of magnitude, which is the first time that this analysis is performed. For example, here I show you the Van der Bosch work that is very, very is incredible. Also, the work they have for order of magnitude for the subhalo mass function. And we see that it's in good agreement with our results. But they can, using multi-DAR simulation and also Bolshoi, well, multi-DAR simulation and for different, these are different way to understand the halos. It's not very important, but it's just to the analysis that they perform in give us different important tasks for the people that use simulations to understand structure formation. The idea is just we have very similar analysis, but we a large range of masses. So with such kind of analysis, now it's possible, is our idea, just to understand what happened with the Wood factor, of course, as we see, and play the game again with the Hanselmann factor and analyze what happened with the expected signal that is very important for the different collaboration, for the Fermi collaboration, CDA, and different work that account that need this kind of assumptions just to use the estimations of the signal to compare with the observation of the signal, expected signal that maybe are possible that we have dark matter as the reason that we have some, for example, signal in particular and so on. No? So every time it's a game between the estimations, the theoretical or phenomenological estimation with observations. So for this reason, it's important to extend the analysis for all the cases in our universe. Well, this is other possibility that we have with the work is just to, for example, extend for other redshift, no? What happened with the structure formation for other, the evolution with time for the structure. And here in the left plot, we see the very, very beautiful result about the structure formation. Why do I say this? Because if we see the blue line, for example, for redshift zero, we have a structure of all, for all, this is the distribution of subhalos inside of halos. So what is the number of subhalos that I have at a given distance? And here, this is the quantity, which is just the position of the subhalo over the virial radius of the host. I mean, this is the radial distribution, the subhalo radial distribution that we have for different host halos at different redshift. So we see, again, the blue line, we see that we have structures for redshift zero, as we expect for recently times, we have a structure at different mass, at different positions, no? And also the number is important. But we go for other redshifts, 0.5, 1, 2, and 4, the line starts to disappear. And this tells us about the structure formation of the universe. So we expect that the we have more structure, as we expect, more structure at recent times. And and also this blue line account for the more massive subhalos inside halos. So the more massive halos are formed in recent times. And when we go to early universe, to the past, we have bigger structures. And this is also so important, not only for indirect detection analysis, but also to understand the structure formation, and everything is connected. What happened with the concentration? Well, we see the evolution with time, that the shape is very similar, but the concentration increased if we go to recent times, so to reach zero. And well, we have here some different shapes for higher masses, so hello higher massive, because for example, we see for redshift 4, the shape changed respect to the redshift 0, redshift 1, and redshift 2, redshift 0.5 or 1 for recent times. When we go to for higher redshift, something happened that we obtain this. This is very similar what happened with halos, and a lot of discussion in the literature for the people that work in these kind of things. And so this is an open issue now for subhalos with this plot. And we are analyzing what happened, but it's important to do more and more analysis. So we'll see. Well, I mean, it's 5 p.m. So just to summarize, the idea was just to discuss the important properties of halos and subhalos, just to define the signal, but also they give us the trip for the different properties, the different assumption that we have to do. For example, what is the kind of analysis, what is the kind of simulation to obtain one or other things, what is the cosmological model that we are assuming, and what is happening, what happened with the power spectrum, what is possible or not, what is interesting and what not, of course. But when we see that a model can to be a possibility for our universe and solve some problems or things for the standard way to define, it's important to include the analysis just to have all the game clear. And of course, when we improve the simulations and also the machine learning techniques and everything numerical kind of methods to understand structure formation will improve, of course, our understanding of everything of Dartmouth researches and structure formation and other topics that are related with that, no? So thank you.
Okay, thank you, Angie, very much for this very interesting talk. Thank you. And we have ample time for questions and comments from the audience.
Okay. Maybe sleeping.
No, they're just shy, come on. So there's a question by Santi. Santi, please.
Hi, Angie. Hi, good talk.
Thanks.
I was wondering what is the, do you have an idea if the effect of baryons could, how it would change like the small scale things, like the concentration and all these kind of things?
Mm-hmm. This is a good question. Of course, it's important to include also. And thanks, because I forgot to talk about it. Yes, of course, it's important to also analyze what happened. For the moment, we have some project to do using the Clue simulation, but for some priority, we are waiting just to continue with this work. But the idea is just to exactly analyze the thing that we are talking about. But you know, we have some works about it. And the one is not very, very important. I mean, it's important, I have to include, because of course we want to start close to the reality, I mean, to the thing that we have in the universe. But I mean, the different uncertainty that I talked before, maybe it's not just the more important one, but it's important, of course, to include.
Yes. Okay. So you know, if there are some, I don't know, because for example, when people analyze, analyzing for like for weak links in studies and things like that, they use some sort of boost factor to account for how the structure changes. I guess there must be something similar in this kind of things, right?
Right, totally. And the lensing is very important just to complement this kind of an analysis. For because it's just another interesting project that I have in mind. It's just to compare with the sun estimation that they have, no, from lensing with this kind of analysis. And of course, it's very interesting and important.
Okay, thanks.
I don't know if I answer your question was about the lensing.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, sorry, I have a problem with the audio. So yeah, the question is, I don't know, like, I mean, in weak lensing or analysis of large scale structure, in the end, people tend to put by hand some boost factor on the power spectrum that they tune to some simulations, and then that they assume that, well, it's like a propagation, right? You have the prediction from dark matter only, and then on top of that, you have a boost factor for the effect of baryons. Mm-hmm. I was wondering if there is some similar approach here.
Yeah, sure. And they have, no, as you know, the strong lensing. So have the possibility just to see the impact of the baryon. I think that is a better way. I mean, it's important to have, again, all the analysis. But for strong lensing, they defined the boost, included the baryons. In other case, in the dark matter, the results are very similar, as you know. Mm-hmm. But I don't remember exactly one work that when they compare one of, I mean, when they obtain the boost factor with baryons. Now, but I remember to read that it's, I mean, it's logical that this is using strong lensing, you can to do a very good method for the boost. So, yes.
Okay. Thanks.
Welcome.
Okay, any more questions, comments from the audience? I have a very quick question. So at some point halfway through your talk, you showed the comparison between cold dark matter, warm dark matter in the interacting models and so on. So have you thought about also a modified gravity at all? Because that's modified gravity at small scales can be degenerate with some of the with these mm-hmm. models.
Yeah, sure. So we didn't did the exercise. I understand that for this kind of model, we have maybe the impact, but for halos, I don't know if it's possible just to extend for sub-halos. I'm not an expert in the topic, but it's nice because in my previous postdoc, I was in Lisbon, all the people worked in modified gravity. And we have some discussion about it, very interesting. And well, the conclusion, and see, this is of course possible to include. Very interesting and open and very exciting project, no? Just to found to combine both point of view of theoretical analysis. We say that for halos, maybe we can found and it's possible to compare, but for other scales, difficult, of course.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. There is a question by Carlos, please.
Yes, very nice talk, Angie. My question is, I mean, I know that your talk was mainly about the distribution of the dark matter, no? But can you say something about the consequences for injury detection in the galaxy and for the present experiments?
Assuming the difference density profile, right?
Yes. Or what time?
Yes, I mean, it's just the problem.
At the sub-halo distribution.
Mm-hmm. Well, at the sub-halo distribution, yes, maybe we have some difference in the inner part, no? I'm looking for the plot for the difference parameterization, sorry, here. So as we see, they have some agreement for the outer part, no, of the halo. and start to play the game of the difference in for more internal parts. So we expect that this, if we remember now the difference, for example, result that we have for concentrations, when we see the distributions of halos, I talk about the concentration because it's the more impact that we have for the signal. Just a minute. I have here some distributions. I didn't want to worry the people, so I don't put maybe the distribution, but here, for example, no? It's account for the distribution of the concentration, no? Depending of the position. We see that depending of the halo and everything that we can do. For example, we see here for 4096, the upper left panel is very flat, the distribution of the concentrations inside the halo. So, this give us an impact in the calculation for sure, but it's not bigger respect to another uncertainties, I suppose. And also, for example, when we compare in our work, we use, for example, what happened if I use NFW for IDM or not, and every time the best parametrization was the NFW. And in general, the people in indirect dark matter searches use the NFW profile. So, but about the comparison, of course, it's interesting. We didn't this for the moment. We all the time, when in the case of substructure, as I say, we didn't need a density profile, but for halos, yes, of course. So it's interesting, no, to maybe to analyze. Maybe some people here that is listening remember some word that really do the, we have a different word now that use, for example, Barker or Iniesto inside the calculations for these kind of things, no? Maybe come to say something, but I hope that in general, when we use simulations just to compare with the different case, just to compare, just to see what happened with the distribution of particles of our matter, even halo using some simulation, the NSW is for the moment the more used, no? And also in just depend. Maybe some people in the public want to say something about it more than the thing that I'm saying. No? I don't see what is the people in the audience. But. So sorry, the idea is just to, of course, to see. For the moment, I didn't use that. I assumed the NFW for halos and didn't use any density profile for subhalos for the different estimations.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Okay, there is one more question by Daniel.
Yes, hi, thank you. Very nice talk. And I was wondering, so maybe it's a very basic question, but I just wanted to ask, for what I understood, the signal is highly influenced by the concentration that you have in low mass halos. And for that, you did extrapolations with different models, for instance, the Prada 12 model. But for what I understand, all those models are calibrated using dark matter only simulation, or like gravity only simulations. And given that you are going to a very low mass range in those halos, have some of the models been constructed using hydrodynamical simulations or other models that take into account more small, the influence of baryonic physics or smaller structures? Because I think that the interpolation there is like huge.
Totally. As we see, no, in the left panel, it's very important to understand what happened with the small one. And the difficult with the simulation is very expensive to study the halos when we go to small masses, no, masses. And also the people is inter- when use the simulation interacting in other projects. I mean, but it's just to put the attention in the small scales. We have in here at Autonoma people that work specifically in this kind of simulation of, with hydro, as you mentioned before. For example, Gustavo Shepes, Alexander, no, they have a lot, well, the cluster, the clues Kluge's collaboration, for example, has a lot of work about it, but it's difficult just to put everything together. For this reason was our motivation, no? In this kind of, for example, this work of Miguel, they use this like a Earth, a Hello Mass, no? For ECC Shama, no? But nothing, we have nothing in the intermediate masses, no? So yes, of course, important to include everything.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. Any more questions? Maybe one last final question from the audience? No. Okay, so if there are no more questions, then we can thank Angie again. Thank you, Angie, for this very nice talk. It was very informative. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good week.